Professor Ramose, one thing that has really interested me much in your work is the fact that in the construction of what Ubuntu is, you in fact draw upon a large body of knowledge, many of which, or much of which, is not African itself. You go to the Indian knowledge, to the Upanishads, and you also use very preferably some eccentric traditions of the West, like David Bohm, for example, Wholeness and the Implicate Order, which I've used in an article, a book of mine, a small book of mine of 1987. I also used that a lot as a critique of modern Western epistemology. So you see that, and then there is another element, which is theology, which is comes very closely to you. That is to say, you have a conception of Ubuntu that does not exoticize it into a kind of a confined African tradition, but you see openings to other cultures in which you can see the same ideas, the same concerns, and so on. What seems to be exceptional, local in particular, is the Western exceptionalism, which became universal not through the strength of ideas, but through the strength of guns that went together with the ideas.
Right.
And insofar as religion is concerned, which is a crucial element in you, in fact, you himself were trained in a Catholic university and so on, you are very critical of Christianity and Islam in the sense that they were alien religions in Africa, so to say, but at the same time, you defend spirituality and also the role that they may perform in Africa, in a sense. I mean, that is to say, the African gods are different. The African religiosity is different from the Western-centric religiosity. They have been coexisting for centuries. The Judeo-Christian religions do not know what to deal with the ancestors. Either they are dead or alive or resurrect.
Okay.
But they are not present here now.
Right.
So.
You see, Professor, the fact that earlier on we reflected on the Ubu aspect of Ubuntu means that the Ubu by itself does not exhaust ontological possibilities that there are. And these ontological possibilities can be encountered once we have Ubuntu, who by his or her own existential conditions and experiences has already developed an Ubuntu. Now, the fact that Ubuntu has been developed on the basis of specific existential experiences does not deprive the Ubu dimension of further encounters with others who may be outside the boundaries of that. And history has made that possible. The history of colonization, the history of Islam in Africa, this has made this possible, that Ubuntu has interacted with other perspectives, philosophical perspectives, religious perspectives. Now, it means that what was known before is still known, but it is still known also at another level in relation to that which was not originally indigenous. Going straight to it philosophically on its own does not mean that I am unaware of the historical encounters. And these historical encounters are important for me at two levels. At the one level, it is that we have to recognize them and deal with them. At another level, these historical encounters already constitute the basis for dialogue among these cultures. So I find it interesting and important that I should even be engaged in dialogue, for example, with Indian philosophy, because this knowledge about India cannot be wished away.
Of course.
So one therefore has to say, what is it that we are talking about and what we can talk about? And that is the reason for this two-track way of doing things.
And sometimes people criticize us that what we do is that we are very selective in the things that we select. That is to say, the things that we think are most adequate, that is to say, the ones that fit our argument.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, intercultural translation seems to be crucial, even though sometimes we are criticized by some that say the culture are incommensurable, and therefore you are confined in what you call also critically bounded reasoning,
yes.
Which I agree with you that is wrong.
Right, yes. In fact, I think that the point of selection is, on the one hand, I would want to say it's a bit natural. I just won't go deep into this, but you know, nature moves along in a particular way by selecting this, that, or the other. But I think from a scientific point of view, it is very critical that one makes a selection. And when you select, it is important to select exactly what you believe is necessary to drive a point home. And you can do it in two ways. Some people do it by just taking only those items which help them to drive their point home. In other words, those in agreement. But others take those in agreement and those in disagreement. And the latter is sometimes, and I think for my part, I believe the latter is more important, because it is a challenge to make you clarify exactly. So you know, selection is not something which is arbitrary or bad by itself. It depends on how one deploys it. In getting over a certain point. And this point means to me that, you know, to confine reasoning into small boundaries that are impermeable. First, the erection of boundaries is a problem. Now, the idea that these boundaries must be impermeable is actually a denial of the possibility that there is an interaction of forces which mutually influence one another. And this mutual influence is important, because as it unfolds, it can result in something other than what we
had before.
And this is the essence of even what one may call transformative constitutionalism. Well, they call it constitutionalism, although I would have preferred constitutionalness. So that this idea that even this constitution, which is there, it's a ness, it is something that is in motion and therefore subject to possibility of change and must be changed. Now, the ism is somehow precluding that by suggesting.
It is interesting that you raise very often the question of the pluriversality. The
pluriverse,
which is today is one of the areas in which many people are still are trying to engage themselves in the idea that instead of a universe, we have a pluriverse. And therefore, there are multiple ways of doing things, and the hierarchies among them have to be judged by the people that are involved in the specific actions that are called for.
That is
to say, in the Western culture, people have focused solely on human rights and not on human duties. While other cultures probably have overstressed the idea of human duties and not so much human rights. And these human rights are usually conceived of in an individualistic way. And that's why today we struggle for collective rights, and the Constitution of Ecuador, as in Article 71, declared for the first time the rights of nature.
I see. Yeah.
Which is very interesting. Nature, of course, not conceived as the natural resources, mm-hmm. but as Mother Earth.
Yes.
So exactly. And the ecology, in a sense, and the ecological disaster and the ecological problems are proving that these other philosophies that had a different conception of nature as Mother Earth, as a living entity to which we belong, not that it belongs to us, is becoming yes. truer and truer. Don't you think so?
I think I like your observation that, you see, there is a kind of spiritual mm-hmm. dimension in these ontological conceptions that have mm-hmm. been sidelined for too mm-hmm. long. Because I was thinking, in the light of the title of your forthcoming book, If God mm-hmm. Were a Human Rights Activist. Mm-hmm. You see, it set me thinking about these matters, because I asked myself, would God be an activist in defense of the crimes against God? Now, this brings me to something that is very important and even in some constitutions quite crucial. Let me come to that slowly.
Yeah, I want that, yeah.
You see, I asked myself, by the way, the crimes against God are known very much in the whole construction of what is called witchcraft. The Christian church actually made sure that it will challenge witchcraft on the note that they are crimes against God. So I was wondering, first, it is the Christian God who is offended by those crimes. Mm-hmm. What happens in the name of human rights if those who do not believe in this God demand to exercise, this time, not witchcraft, but sorcery? My point is that sorcery is now recognizing something ontologically mm-hmm. That I think the crafters of witchcraft have recognized in a small way. Mm-hmm. And this is that what we call nature does have forces, visible or invisible, mm-hmm. but these forces are ontological, and these forces can be described in two categories. The forces of good and the forces of evil. So, if you have the forces of good and the forces of evil, those, even before the invention of Satan, that mm-hmm. is, or before right. the invention of the devil, mm-hmm. these forces were able to influence how people live. They did, and they continue to influence how people live, especially in Africa. Mm-hmm. But ironically, even in South Africa and next door in Zimbabwe, you have the Witchcraft Act.
Yeah.
So my point is, when you study the Witchcraft Act, what you find is that it is addressing the same old idea of witchcraft. It doesn't speak to the ontology that sorcery is dealing with. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. In that way, it is not addressing what many people are practicing in terms of badimu, mm-hmm. or what people call the ancestors. Mm-hmm. You see, mm-hmm. now, the fact that one relates to what one calls ancestors is by itself a recognition of this ontological bifurcation of forces, mm-hmm. of the forces of good and the forces of evil. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so the Nyanga now called, so-called witch doctor. Nyanga is not a witch doctor. Mm-hmm. Nyanga is not a witch doctor.
Yeah, Nyamusoro.
Exactly. or Chiremba in Shona. These are not witch doctors because they are not committing any crimes against God.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it is a misnomer to describe them as
witch
doctor, mm-hmm. or even to call them witch doctor. It is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when we look at it in that way, there is a big problem because the ontology of Ubuntu and many other African perspectives on this is that you do have us, the living. You do have also the living dead.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why I want to put the word ancestor in the deep freezer,
mm-hmm.
because it does not quite precisely speak to this concept of the living dead.
Mm-hmm.
Let me give you an example. You see, the term ancestor is passive. It can mean somebody before me.
Mm-hmm.
And when Rhodesians had problems in Zimbabwe, Britain decided to issue what they call ancestry visa. Of course, it was a racist idea to say only white people will claim ancestry in Britain and therefore they will go.
That's right.
So it has no religious connotation at all.
Mm-hmm.
And it does not at the same time speak to what is crucial.
Mm-hmm.
What is crucial with the idea of the living dead is that those who are gone are understood to be still alive. Hence the prefix living first.
Mm-hmm.
Dead is simply to acknowledge the invisibility mm-hmm. of their presence.
Mm-hmm.
You see, but their presence is vibrant and alive with us.
Mm-hmm.
And so from that point of view, you can see that if you align yourself with them, you also align yourself with the power to deal with these forces of good and evil. And so if you deal with these forces of good and evil, according to their prescription, then it will be so that you will also be responsible, as it were,
mm-hmm.
to the yet to be born in two ways.
Mm-hmm.
First, by preserving the land,
mm-hmm.
because the land is life for those who are yet to come.
Mm-hmm.
And first also by participation in the procreative act.
Mm-hmm.
And when you look at it that way, you can see why it is important from an African perspective to somehow have children.
Mm-hmm.
Because the having of children is carrying out the duty first to co-create in order to give life.
Mm-hmm.
And when you don't have children, well, you can go the other way. Because nulliparity is something that we know, but according to Western law, for example, nulliparity in the past mm-hmm. was one of the reasons you could adduce for divorce.
That's right.
Now, with us, if somebody is barren, you don't divorce. You discuss, you go have another wife who will bear the children. So polygamy is not something accidental or ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
It has got a lot of rationale behind
mm-hmm.
it.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that you consult, you don't get the second or the third or the fourth stealthily by the corners.
Mm-hmm.
It is something that is put on the table. I think that a lot of psychologists would agree that what you don't have to hide is easy to deal with than mm-hmm. that which you have to hide.
Yeah. Well, so that's quite controversial, of course.
Exactly.
Under the current conditions of South Africa, being in favor of polygamy may have some political take also.
Well, it may have.
But our discussion doesn't touch
exactly.
that.
Exactly. You see, what I'm touching at the moment is exactly this spiritual dimension,
yeah, of course,
which is not even recognized. That is why an Ubuntu understanding person would still have reason to challenge mm-hmm. the basic point of departure of the Witchcraft mm-hmm. Act. But and that's what made me think of your book and say, oh, now, where are we? Now, take Benin, for example. Mm-hmm. Benin constitutionally has got three religions, Christianity, Islam, and Voodoo. Mm-hmm. Three.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, for somebody, voodoo is nonsense. Yeah. But for
them, of
Benin,
course.
Oh, yes, no, it is constitutionally for the Haitians, recognized.
Right. In Haiti.
And Haiti.
Yeah, of course.
Yes.
Of course.
You see, yeah. So when we look at this, we yeah. see that there is even contestation about what nature and what the land means.
No, I take very seriously your criticism and your comment, which is very fair comment, that in my book, If God Were a Human Rights Activist, I start from a Judeo-Christian God, and therefore I have to reformulate or write another book based on other conceptions. But I have to ask you this, because in terms of life and death, mm-hmm. It is very interesting to see these complexities, important. In fact, I see them in other cultures, as I say. In the Andean region also, I have been part of my research. Mm-hmm. I have been in many situations in which the titans, which are considered the chiefs, when they are negotiating with the state in some events, they say the ancestors, the living dead, are with them, mm-hmm. and they are sitting around them.
Yes.
And the members of the government, of course, don't understand that,
right.
and say, well, consult them. There's a story that I always tell to my students, when the Minister of Environment came to consult about oil drilling project in the mountains. And the Indians were there, the chiefs were there, and they said, well, they listened to the minister. The minister offered lots of things, schools, roads, hospitals, as a result of this new wealth that they would have out of the mining and out of mm-hmm. the oil drilling. And in the end, asked them, what do you think? Mm. And the titans, the chiefs, remained absolutely silent.
Mm-hmm.
And the minister got a little bit nervous and asked to the secretary, did I say something wrong? These guys don't respond to me. And so on. He'll ask again. Mm-hmm. And then the oldest titan rose his hand and said, well, we would like very much to respond to you, mm-hmm. but we have to consult our ancestors.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, but your ancestors are dead.
Yeah.
So why should they be consulted?
Yeah.
You know, they said, no, they are living.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, then consult them. I'll wait.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they are here. They are here with us. But don't consult them.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, no, we only consult our ancestors in the full moon.
Mm-hmm.
And today there is no full moon.
Right.
And the minister said, you're making fun of me. I'm leaving. My helicopter has to go back to Bogota. You don't want to speak. Of course, the people wanted to speak with the minister, but in their own terms.
Precisely.
And not in the terms of the minister.
I
think we have to go inside
yeah.
for the next question. Okay, Professor Ramose, we were discussing these questions of African religiosity and African gods in contrast with Judeo-Christian traditions and also, of course, Islam, to which it also belongs. The way in which they were alien religions in Africa, and then in one way or the other, we have on one side the African religiosity and all these other religions, mm-hmm. but there is a lot of hybridity, of things that mix together, and some of the African religions sometimes gets all kinds of influences from the Christianity particularly and from Islam, which is interesting because there are different Islams now in Africa. One that has used to be called the Africanized Islam, because that the Islam that has been here for a long, long time and in fact got adapted in many ways to the lives of people. I remember doing some field research in Angosh, in the northern part of Mozambique, which is a very Islamic tradition, region, and in fact see how adapted in the community and in the community ways this kind of Islam was. But coming to this religiosity, which also goes back to the idea of ontology, and the ontology of the visible and the invisible beings, there is one problem that sometimes arises, is that on one side, these conceptions of Ubuntu and similar conceptions in other cultures, they allow for something that I've always complained that Western modernity didn't allow for, which is the care for the future generations, the not yet born. Because in fact, even all the philosophy of human rights is about living entities, and therefore we ruin the planet and with the ecological disaster and so on, because in fact these future generations have no rights. While other cultures, in fact, they take good care of those not yet born entities, so to say, right? This may be polemical for other conceptions for which the fact that the newborn is there is a new living being with full dignity, full human rights, in theory, of course, as a child, as a newborn. Mm-hmm. But the questions of rituals, initiations, and other ceremonies that seem to be crucial to make he or she acceptable in the community, how relevant are they for the ontology of Ubuntu, the Ubuntu as an ontology of these newborns?
Yeah. Well, thanks. I think the first point I would like to mention there is this one, that actually when a baby is born, in fact, it is a human being who is born. Mm-hmm. And so it is recognized as such, as a human being. It is then the next step to, as it were, constitute the baby into a person. Mm-hmm. So therefore, there is a distinction to be made, mm-hmm, between being a human being and being a person. Mm-hmm. So personhood is what one acquires through various ceremonies at different stages of one's life. But the one who acquires all these characteristics of personhood is already and immediately recognized as at birth as a human being. You see? Mm-hmm. So a human being is always there involved. And the rituals, like in so many other religions, are made precisely in reverence of the fact that, mm-hmm, there is now a human being. What then do we do to make the life of this human being better? Mm-hmm. And that is one of the reasons why naming of children or babies is crucial. And there is something important about these ontologies, African ontologies in this regard, which I think free cultures, as they call themselves, the cultures of Europe. I can be Petra, I can be Mareike. You see, what's wrong? I can be Ute, you see. I don't have to be Peter, for example. Now, the baby going through these rituals does require a ceremony suited to that stage of babyhood. And these ceremonies usually are performed on the advice of the, I don't even want to call them traditional healers. Mm-hmm. As we discussed, they certainly are not witch doctors. Mm-hmm. So these chirembas, mm-hmm, they are the ones who will either advise or show what to be done during the ceremony. This is because even in the naming or in any other ceremony, the role of the living dead is recognized in a serious way. Mm-hmm. So if I were to give my child a name that has got no meaning at all in this family lineage, I could discover that bitterly later on in life. For example, if the baby or the young man or the young girl at some point experiences problems, and I go to Chiremba to ask, well, what do we do? Some Chirembas use questions like they would ask you, what is your family name? You tell the surname. And when you tell the surname, they also ask, what is your name? You tell your name. And then they are now going to use those as a way, as the key to open the door for communication with your gods. Mm-hmm. Well, if it happens that you have not named the child, or sometimes you urbanize, you change even your surname, well, it is so that the Chiremba will return with a locked door. Yes, the Chiremba will return with a locked door, because neither the name nor the surname does not ring any bell. The gods don't know this, therefore the gates are locked. You will have, he or she will have to ask you probing questions to see if you ever have changed the surname, to ask if this child is named after your uncle, your auntie, which auntie in the lineage. And it is a process. Mm-hmm. It is only after the correct name or surname has been identified that the doors will be unlocked. Mm-hmm. Now, one would have to ask the question, is it so that this is an epistemology of the irrational? Mm-hmm. This can be true. This is just imaginings. It is fiction. Maybe. Now I give you a concrete experience I had quite recently. You may know that I was exiled for more than 2 decades. Mm-hmm. And before I left the country, we were running around as political activists. And so we met one another, and I met a certain friend. We really became friends with this gentleman. And then I left. Later on, I heard that he escaped into Lesotho. And then we couldn't quite keep contact. Lesotho was problematical. Anyway, I subsequently heard that he died. Okay. And then, it was many years ago. Now, in these years of 2000, I went to the University of Free State for some discussions there. And then I asked one of the colleagues to show me the university library. So we walked, and as you walk to go to the library, there is a spot. It's a restaurant, it is banks, you have also a place where students are just typing and doing this and that. There's lots of students as you pass. So I must mention that this colleague was white, and so belonged to a different epistemological orientation. So we walked, we were passing, talking, and she was a teacher of epistemology. Mm-hmm. She was a philosopher there, so she taught epistemology. So we walked past, and then as we passed, after some time, I was feeling funny behind me. I said, but what's wrong? So when I looked, I saw a certain young boy running really fast, running after. So I was wondering, what is this? And he came facing me. So I was wondering, but I don't know this boy. What's wrong? He came running. And so we stopped with this lady. We were a bit surprised. And then he said he didn't even greet me or anything like that. He just told me, yes, I know that you know my father. Look at me. I am his son. You see, but I don't know him. Where is he? Dude, can you tell me his story? Please tell me his story. I know that you know him. I looked. He mentioned the name of the father. Exactly the son of that guy. Exactly. So I began to, because when he went to Lesotho, his mother was pregnant. And then he was killed by the regime. I didn't even know the mother. He was killed by, the father was killed by the regime before the son was born. That's why he doesn't know his father. And now for some reason, he comes to me. And for sure, I knew his father. But the question was, we asked, now we discussed later. I'm still in touch with this little boy, his young man. He's studying there at the University of Free State. We are still in contact because we cannot solve the riddle. How did he know that I know his father? Especially because he did not even see my face. I had passed him when he was sitting. So I asked him, why? He said, I don't know. Something just told me, stand up, run, and that man will tell you stories about your father. So our Western epistemologist was puzzled. I told her, well, you may be puzzled, but this is now the ontology of the living dead. Mm-hmm. They speak. Even, I really, it was my first time to go to the University of the Free State. It was, even today, I'm still trying to think, how is this possible? Mm-hmm. But what I gathered, I learned from that experience, is that one may not take this ontology for granted. It may not be taken mm-hmm. for granted. Mm-hmm. If you take it for granted, then of course you must also take Fatima for granted.
That's right. That's a good point.
Exactly. You can't go. You must just be. You see. So I
and I'm very suspicious of Fatima.
Exactly. You see. So these Fatimas, these Saint Peters, these what? You see. They really, these Chirembas, mm-hmm. For me, they are people with extraordinary gifts, not powers. Now, these Chirembas have that type of contact with these forces which we talk about ontology.
They are the transformers.
Exactly. They are just the transformers. You see, they are tuned better than other human beings. That's why I call it a gift, because they don't do it themselves. Mm-hmm. They just receive it.
People in Africa, do they live by a double religious consciousness? Dubois' expression of double consciousness, double religious consciousness of sometimes consider themselves Catholic or Protestants, and at the same time believing in other religious experiences that are far above or beyond these more Western-centric religion experiences.
Yeah, indeed you're right. I'm glad for this question because you do have those type of people. I see some writers call them Christians by day, Africans by night. You see, so you know, it means that the African existential religious experience is not dead. It's not. It is refusing to go. Because uncle, auntie, this and that, they're practicing it. But for daytime, because you must look honest, it is not there. Mm-hmm. For daytime, because you have not yet understood the arrogance of the term superstition, mm-hmm. you think you must look good and not look superstitious. Superstition is nothing more than one religious arrogance against another. Yeah. Okay. So, you know, when you understand it in those terms, mm-hmm. you can even mm-hmm. laugh at it. Mm-hmm. That's one point. Now, there are those who live this, indeed, double consciousness. Mm-hmm. And you see, this double consciousness, we must remember, is reinforced also by the promises of colonization. One of the promises of colonization is theology. Mm-hmm. You see? So, when you look at this idea, the Theos Logos, theology is not religion.
Of course not, yeah.
It is not. So, theology even situates God in the sphere of metaphysics. Mm-hmm. I doubt if African religions ever, situate God in the sphere of metaphysics. Mm-hmm. It is all the way ontological. Mm-hmm. For example, the term that people use sometimes, translators, like the Swedish missionary, they use the term for God, unkulunkulu. But when you analyze, as an African, understanding the Zulu meaning, it says nothing. It just says the big, 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 big. Just the big, 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 big what? The big, 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 big what? You see, it is no content. It is empty. What's the big? Mudimu. Mudimu is exactly. Motuwa hudimu. You see, and when you look at it that way, this motuwa hudimu, it puts God exactly and immediately in the anthropological plane.
But which is a very old story, but you remember that when the Jesuits and all the others, the missionaries arrived in Latin America,
yes,
and some were Portuguese, the others Spanish, they also had this trouble in trying to explain God to a personal God to the indigenous people that, of course, didn't have that notion of the personal
Precisely.
God. And they learned the language. There is one, a famous one, José Anchieta, that wrote a book, hundreds of pages, to explain the word God to them, because it was so complicated that he was writing his notes and kept writing in order to identify what would be something similar to what they understood, because God for them was everywhere, was part, is the transcendent, but not the world beyond.
Precisely.
Is this world transcendent?
Exactly. And that is why in our earlier discussion I said I would come back to the term metaphysics. Mm-hmm. Because I even doubt that there is such a thing as African metaphysics. Mm-hmm. You see, it is an assimilation. Mm-hmm. We have as one of the branches of philosophy, metaphysics. Therefore, we must have African metaphysics without actually visiting and investigating the existential experience of the Africans to see if indeed it yields the concept metaphysics. Mm-hmm. You see, just because we are educated in that discipline, there must be African metaphysics. So theology then just proceeds from there, you see. And then it proceeds in a way that really creates problems for those who are African religion oriented, because you have two streams now. Those who actually have been taught Christian theology would like to speak the language of African theology, just like those who want to speak the language, who have been taught Western philosophy, want to talk about African metaphysics without really serious investigation. This is what bothers me.
Okay.
Now, what I see in this is this borrowing of terms. And it is not just borrowing, it is going to commit you to something so that you will end up, I think, for example, you can remember the Archbishop of Lusaka, Milingo. Now,
That's
he's
right.
an interesting example, because Archbishop Milingo was at the same time a gifted African by the gods. And so for the Christians, you cannot be a Christian Archbishop and still go and throw bones. It doesn't make sense for them. So, well, the best thing is we take him to Rome. He must be mad. So we must remove him, because these gods that he is talking to certainly cannot be gods. And you see, in his book, The River Between, he then describes Jesus as the senior ancestor. That, of course, is a colonial imposition. You see, you can see now that once you have imbibed this Christian theology or Western philosophy in the area of metaphysics, the temptation is great to talk the language of African theology or African metaphysics. And this is what I'm challenging. I'm saying it is now more than time overdue for us to really make a deeper and fresh inquiry, as it were, as to whether indeed we can talk about these gods as understood by the Africans. Can we talk about them as God first in the monotheistic understanding of this? Second, as God who is in the metaphysical world.
Of course.
When we look at that, I think one of the issues which must come to the fore is to remember what Etienne Gilson is arguing, namely that, you see, God is not a scientific probability, but a metaphysical necessity.
Exactly.
Exactly. But that is if you are schooled in Western philosophy and Western theology. If you are nurtured and brought up in the domain of African religion, then the gods are not even a scientific probability, but a living reality manifested by contact and communication Absolutely. With the living dead.
So, what is then the place, if any, for the Black liberation theology? Because after all, there has been a tradition of, and a very important tradition at that, with many books published on the Black Christian theology.
True.
But there is probably other theologies, or the African religion as you are describing, are they accessible to theological thinking as the one that is typical of the Judeo-Christian tradition? Or you think that to think theologically, that is to say in terms of revelation, about the African religiosity, would be an absurdity?
Well, you see, there one would have a problem. We have to recognize that faith is a matter beyond knowledge. You don't need to know. That is why you will believe. One point. The second point is that if we say we must think theologically, what theological paradigm is at issue? So having made these two points, I want to say that, you know, what I see in the writings, even of liberation theology, let's take also even my brothers in Latin America on that.
Whom you like very much.
I like them very much.
My dear friend Leonardo Boff and
exactly,
others will be very happy to listen
Boff.
To this conversation.
Exactly. But you see, as I was looking and studying the writings in liberation theology, there came a point when I asked myself, because, for example, even Leonardo Boff has got his book, Jesus Christ the Liberator. So, you know, I was asking myself, remove Jesus. If you decent, just remove Jesus. Would talk about liberation still be possible?
Of course.
All right? And so, if talk about liberation would be possible, then of course, in a way, liberation theology is a theology anchored on the salvific and liberative, because also Boff has written a booklet, Salvation and Liberation. And I believe the distinction he makes between salvation and liberation is quite crucial. So, if we exclude the salvific mission of Jesus, would it be so that we will still have liberation without Jesus Christ?
But my problem, my problem is not Jesus Christ. It's the way he or she is imposed. I mean, the problem is that the Catholic Church or the Protestant, in all the colonial enterprise, they were up for conversion.
Exactly.
They want to convert people.
Exactly.
So conversion, you know, if you take a decolonial conception of religion, I think we have to be very critical of these religions because, in fact, the end, they may be liberation, and I deal with it in my books, as you do, and with liberation, and I grant that they have participated in very important struggles, but at the core of these theologies is the idea that I'm converting you. That is to say, my religion is better than your non-religion.
Exactly, and that is where the problem lies. That is why I focus even on Jesus Christ, because as you may be aware, I'm sure you are, theologically speaking, Jesus is meaningless. Mm-hmm. Jesusology is meaningless without Christology. Mm-hmm. So Christology really anchors and affirms. Mm-hmm. Sousa. So when we look at it from that point, that is why I want first to, it is exactly because of this Christological dimension that they believe mm-hmm. and maintain that you can now get a pope signing, for example, Romanus Pontifex, mm-hmm. which of course right. was given also even to Portugal, mm-hmm. to say, now you can go. A Juntes Docenti.
That's right.
Yes, you must now go and teach all nations and convert them.
And conquer.
And conquire. You must conquer. You see, and not only conquer, the only right they have is to be converted or killed. Mm-hmm. That is
That's
it.
Right.
It was just as vicious in its unethical thrust and intention as colonization as a political aspect to it. They are the same. So this mission to proselytize, mm-hmm. even up to the point of killing, we have experienced it in many mm-hmm. ways in mm-hmm. all parts of Africa. One of the outstanding ones, as you may know, is the fires of Namugongo mm-hmm. in Uganda, where people died. They were carrying wood, like firewood, like babies. And of course, you put on the fire and they must die because they refuse conversion. Now, that is how strong belief in African gods was, and people were ready to die for it. Now, this liberation theology in South Africa, in Latin America, for me, the problematical dimension is exactly what you mentioned, that somehow seems to accept that conversion to Christianity is after all good. Mm-hmm. Therefore, let us use Christianity as a means towards mm-hmm. our liberation. And it has mm-hmm. been used effectively and efficiently. I don't deny that. Otherwise, Bush next door and Reagan would not have gone to the Pope and told him, keep your boys quiet. Mm-hmm. You
That's
see,
right.
it in that way it was efficient, but it was efficient by appeal to Christ. Mm-hmm. Now, what I'm saying is that this appeal to Christ is not essential mm-hmm. for the liberation struggle of anyone, including the liberation struggle of the peoples of Africa.
Yeah. I agree with you, and quite frankly, I think that conversion would only be possible if counter-conversion would also be possible. That is to say, it could be reciprocal,
exactly.
but which is not thought of as reciprocal. Uh-huh. But as you move along, looking at the conceptions, African gods, African philosophy, you very eloquently, I think, provide a very sophisticated picture of your living experience and theorized experience, mm-hmm. which is really a very rare combination. Because usually, as a good friend of mine says, Lewis Gordon, who used to come to here, experience is black, theory is white. Mm-hmm. Here, no, this is the theory and this is the experience. We are in a global process of African philosophizing. But who is African? My question is, if I dare to ask, I ask. If not, I don't. But I, of course, start to ask to you. Are the whites in South Africa Africans?
Yes, let me rephrase your question by, if you permit me, going back to what I said I want to put in brackets. I mm-hmm. think now this is the right time to actually go back to that. Mm-hmm. That was the whole idea of what does it mean to call someone a colored?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now, I want to start from there. You see, of course, Michel Foucault, borrowing from Plato, argues, and I think I can see his point. He argues in his History of Sexuality that the sexual urge, what he calls the sting of desire, mm-hmm. is available to every human being. The clever ones, the foolish, the mad ones, the rich, and the poor. Mm-hmm. This sting of desire is available to them. And the problem is that we pretend that there is some rationality in this sting of desire by somehow telling people you may not respond to the sting of desire if you are underage, if you don't have money, if you don't have this, if you are mad. So we put all kinds of nice things around this, and Michel Foucault is wondering, but why? I call this because not so long ago, we were shown slides in Bremen, in Germany, about the General Van Trotta, who went and massacred the people in Namibia. Okay, so when we were watching the slides, I then asked him after he completed, are you sure there is just one slide not missing? He said, no, I showed everything. I said, no, I am doubting. I really don't think you showed. Please check again. He checked, but he got a bit irritated. So I said, okay, you know, if you're sure you check, there is just one slide missing. And this is the slide concerning these men. They were all German soldiers, men. But where is a German woman going together with them? There was no single German woman accompanying these men. But 9 months after their arrival, there were babies crying. In Namibia, there were babies. And you see, given the ideology of the time that we are not human beings, why were they able to respond to the sting of desire as if things are normal? Why were our sisters, our grannies, and everybody, just like the crew of Jan van Riebeek, they didn't all bring women here. And then the 9 months after they land, their little babies crying all over. Suddenly they tell us, ha, these are colors. You see, they're taking distance from the result of what happened. They are beginning to take distance. They want to say, like Shakespeare, they look human, but they're not quite human. Mm-hmm. See, so they are colored. No, they are not colored. Colored into what? Because if you are a little child at school like we were, we used to buy crayons, coloring material. Mm-hmm. So you get a blank white sheet and you are told, please color it. After that, it would be colored. Now, what was the original color of the colored before they were colored? What was the original color? You see, there is no colored. What we are trying to avoid is to recognize these as equal and ordinary human beings like us. Mm-hmm. We are trying to avoid that. So we use political devices, sociological terms to try and pretend. You know, there is a nice name in French, but I think St. Augustine is also party to that. Dieudonné, Adeodatus, given by God. You have a child, you take distance.
It was the name of his son.
Exactly, Deodatus. That was the name of Augustine's son. So he, because he believed, now he doesn't want actually to face the consequences of his sexual act. Yeah. So it was not my sex, it was a gift from God. So Dieudonné, you see this, no. There is no colored. The colored is a human being with a name. So call him by name. Why do you want to think in terms of color? Now, I think that color-oriented reasoning with regard to human beings is the first mistake. We don't need that. The fact that when they came here and they made children with our mothers, our sisters, and our grandchildren, and whatever, the fact that they made children with them is more than enough evidence to say, oh, we are all human, and also human, to think of Nietzsche. You see, we are also human, and so human. So we are, biology tells us that we are one. We are one. And there was a nice program on the BBC, in the blood, it was called, meaning in the blood we are one, but divided we stand because we think in terms of color, black, yellow, blue, and green. For me, these guys have already proven that they are Africans by refusing to be our sons-in-law. Maybe they were thinking, if they don't call them colors, we will now want lobola, you see, and they have to pay lobola, so they better call them colored, you see. No, but that already. So, you know, that question for me is no longer a basic fundamental issue, because color-oriented reasoning is a fallacy. The question is, are you a human being? Do you decide to regard yourself as a human being who can be described as Ghanaian, as South African, as Mozambican? That is a matter of choice. But that you are here in Africa, born in Africa, not sharing like them, they did not share their culture, they imposed it for their own ends, but there is no cultural interaction and reciprocity. So in a way, they can claim that they are not Africans, although they are in Africa. I think that claim is rather not so deep, because for them to really be convincing, they still have to answer the question, well, let us put African like colored in brackets. Let us put those ones in brackets and think just about whether or not we are humans.
That's wonderful.
And if we are human beings, we will construct a human-oriented world, not a color-constructed world. That is the problem.
That's a wonderful answer, in my view, and in fact coincides very much with a colleague from Senegal, that the name escapes me now, is an historian, that says that we have to abandon the chromatic thinking, which is basically the same way.
Exactly.
And in fact, in one of your texts, you are saying precisely, and I quote, that you'd like to have a race-neutral concept for the analysis that you are taking, because you were including in that group. In the last category, I didn't know whether white scholars were involved. Were the conquered, the African, the conquered, subjugated, and those suffered from subjugation. That is to say, there are different layers of domination in Africa, and you assuming that people that are not originally from here in immemorial times, but with all the contradictions of that, they have been here for generations and so on, they may have also been victims of subjugations, of exclusions, discrimination. Is that Well, your thinking.
Yes, what I'm suggesting there is that, you know, if this line of divide between conqueror and conquered is taken seriously, then of course the experiences of both are in a way different. Mm-hmm. But because of the interaction between the two, the one resisting conquest and its consequences, the other one trying their best to maintain the so-called right of conquest and its consequences. In this struggle, what will emerge in terms of liberation, if it is liberation proper, mm-hmm. is that both categories will dissolve, mm-hmm. will dissolve. And the dissolution of these two categories means that each one of us will stand on a different plane of freedom than before. Mm-hmm. And this is what I'm saying.
Absolutely.
So that you see, it therefore means it will our struggle for freedom must have the effect of freeing even the subjugator.
Absolutely.
This is what I'm getting at.
But you have a very good ancestors here with Mrs. Air and others that also mentioned that. And there is a final issue that I'd like to discuss with you, Professor Ramos, and all of what we have been discussing has to do with education, with knowledge, of course, African knowledge, indigenous knowledge systems, as sometimes they are called. And now, how all this richness, how this marvelous thinking, complex thinking about the realities of Africa, that after all can be explained in a ways that are not so esoteric, they may be accessible to people. None of this is taught in our universities here in South Africa, probably in your courses, but I don't see that very much there. Mm-hmm. Other knowledges are there, mm-hmm. and you are very concerned. I've been very concerned with university. I wrote almost two or three books on the need for the university to reform itself, the polyphonic university, as I call it, the need for the university to open up to the ecology of knowledges, that is to say, to scientific knowledges and non-scientific knowledges, so that not just the knowledge of the winners, but also the knowledge of the losers mm-hmm. come into the university. So I'm very much aware of this politics of knowledge as it transforms itself into a curriculum. Mm-hmm. In fact, we see that in African universities, or universities in Africa,
exactly,
you don't see, in fact, still a very convincing expression of these realities, of this knowledge, of these interactions in our curriculum, in our courses. On the contrary, is still very much based on the mimesis. And one of the authors that you, and I'd like you to address this, because it may even have to do with some of your, your black stars, as you say in one text, like Nkrumah again. When Nkrumah says that the students of philosophy in Africa should study philosophy with a different spirit mm-hmm. from the counterparts that teach philosophy or learn philosophy in Europe or elsewhere. What is this different spirit? Learn the same philosophy? Because they have to learn the ideas that you don't, and I want to hear you about that. These African philosophies, which seem so rich and are outside the curriculum, probably, and they interact in your book, with your books, with the Western philosophy, other Eastern philosophies. So these philosophies have to be taught from the African perspective, in a sense, with a specific spirit. What is the spirit? Is the spirit of a continent that was subjugated, a victim of mimesis, occupation and mimesis, and has to do now an oppositional reading, a critical reading, a deconstructive reading, a reconstructive reading, but a reading. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How do you see the curriculum in Africa to be truthful to what we have been discussing today here?
Yes, thanks very much for that. You see, Professor, we already indirectly, but I'm glad you raised this now in quite pointed form. Indirectly, I referred to Ali Mazrui describing the African University. I'm now saying the African University. Mm-hmm. The African University as not more than a transmission belt of the Western epistemological paradigm. Mm-hmm. Now, that is why it is the African University, because it is yet non-African. It is just an agent of an epistemology that serves the ends of the West. So in that sense, it is not an African university, and therefore it is a university in Africa. Mm-hmm. But it is a university in Africa, really, really, as it were, looking to the north and being fed from the north. Mm-hmm. Now, this is not an accident. It is one of the privileges of the so-called right of conquest, that it may just commit epistemicide. So it calls for a reaction in the liberation struggle. Now, you may recall that the subtitle of Nkrumah's Conscientism is actually philosophy and ideology for decolonization. Right. And that is in that text that Nkrumah argues that, you see, when an African student of philosophy goes really to study philosophy, they may do so provided they do not study in the same spirit. I'm glad you mentioned that. They do not study in the same spirit as their Western, and for that matter, even Eastern counterparts. Mm-hmm. But because the Western has got greater impact, for a long historical impact, that is why he identifies the West. Now, what does this not in the same spirit mean? Well, it is interesting that you have, for example, books by the title, Critical History of Western Philosophy, A History of Western Philosophy, multiple volumes by Frederick Copleston, the Jesuit. Mm-hmm. You have a History of Russian Philosophy. You have a History of American Philosophy, A History of Chinese Philosophy. It is seldom asked, but who really are the Chinese? Who really are the Russians? It is taken for granted that as soon as you begin to talk the language, a history of African philosophy, the first thing is, are you really serious? Is there such a thing as an African philosophy? Mm-hmm. Okay. So this philosophy has been excluded, just like the term Ubuntu, as I have described, mm-hmm. even in the textbooks. So this exclusion was the exclusion by reason of the power that those had who ruled Africa. Mm-hmm. And so we couldn't find it in the curricula. We couldn't find it. And we still do not find much of it. There is resistance. We were talking, I will give you two examples, two other experiences. I was invited to teach medical students, final year medical students, at a very famous university here in this country, on African ethics. The first day of my appearance, the students were objecting. But we don't need this. We are going to be doctors. Why are you here, in fact? What is it? What is this? I say, oh, I see, you have a problem. Well, I did not actually compose the curriculum. I was just invited after the curriculum was composed. So it may be good to address this question to the others. To me, you can address the question, exactly what is African ethics and why should you be taught? That one I can deal with. but not why you should be here. Well, luckily, after discussion, they finished. They followed the whole course. It was resistance, but somehow, finally, they followed. So there is a kind of spontaneous negativity to what is African in these universities. At another time, I was supposed to work together with colleagues to construct a study guide on legal ethics. And so by the time I got into this team, they had already decided on prescribed books and so on and so on. So I had to familiarize myself with the books. So one of the books I read, the author stated that the book is actually intended for an average educated American. So I asked my colleagues, what is the South African equivalent of an average educated American? We literally spent 2 years debating the issue before the course was introduced, because I couldn't find that in South Africa. They didn't know what it was. So I was asking, since you don't know what it is and we don't have it, why do you use even this book? We can do with other books which have to do with African ethics. And that was the area of contestation. So I'm saying that despite the new constitutional dispensation, curriculum inscription of the African voice and African experience is problematical, partly because of the Constitution. You see, we mustn't forget, Professor, that the Constitution is a gentleman's agreement. It has many layers. One of the layers is it is a gentleman's agreement to continue apartheid by constitutional means. Why? Because you do have provision for group rights. But instead of calling them group rights, they are now called cultural and linguistic rights. So that by virtue, you may appeal to the Constitution to say, at my university, we are going to teach only in Afrikaans or only in English. We want to protect our culture, we want to protect, therefore we will do this. You are constitutionally within your rights. So apartheid is still there. You see, the same exclusions that you had in apartheid are built now into the Constitution. So even if you say, okay, we want a curriculum which actually has an African experience content, then they say, you can do it. You have your right to do it, but not here. Here we don't want it. We then, of course, in fact, there have been schools and universities which already have gone to the courts on this point. So from that point of view, the continuation of apartheid by constitutional means is what is already there. It is a living reality of today. Now, because of these experiences, I think Nkrumah was even prescient. He could see long before time that these will be problems when he was talking about studying these subjects in a different spirit. In a different spirit means, for example, he went, well, I also have been taught Western philosophy.
Course.
And as you know, my alma mater in Belgium is supposed to be one of the creams of philosophy in Europa. Okay, César. So we studied Hegel, we studied Kant. Do you think we ever really were introduced to the epistemology of these great Western philosophers as having more than an element of racism? No, we did. You see, so this is what Nkrumah is asking. Say, you have got an experience. When you go to Belgium, you go to Oxford or wherever, your experience is different from those ones. Now, if they talk Kant and stop at this nice critique der reinen Vernunft and so on, without actually investigating whether or not this has got
Kant and the Negro.
Exactly. So you must now investigate. You must now ask from the point of view of your experience, what does Kant mean to me? What does Hegel mean to me? What does Karl Marx mean to me? I must confess, you know, it was quite an overdose. Like you mentioned earlier in your discussion, the Grundnorm of Hans Kelsen. Yeah. And now you can see that we who do not have a metaphysics surely don't need the Grundnorm of Kelsen as far as the construction of the constitution is concerned. Mm-hmm. That this is what Nkrumah means, mm-hmm. that you must be consciously critical about what you learn. Mm-hmm. But you cannot acquire that critical consciousness if you do not take your experience seriously.
Absolutely.
You must take your existential, historical experience seriously. Once you do so, you will get into an engaging and fruitful dialogue mm-hmm. with these philosophies. They are not there as eternal truths. Mm-hmm. They stand there as texts for criticism. Mm-hmm. So studying in that spirit, to use the terminology of Serek Behan, African philosophy, or just African teaching in general, should be the hermeneutics of resistance. Mm-hmm. Because it is meeting resistance all the time. So the hermeneutics of resistance is what we require mm-hmm. to have these things inscribed in the curricula. Not because of us only as Africans, exactly even for the sake of those who resist, because if they knew what they were missing, they would not even mm-hmm. resist. Mm-hmm. So for their own freedom, because they are still, to use Wittgenstein here, they are just captives of a picture, mm-hmm. and they must be released from that picture mm-hmm. prison. Mm-hmm. And to do so, the African philosophy or hermeneutics of resistance must be intensified.
Absolutely.
And it must come into the community.
I absolutely agree with you, and quite frankly, I think that if you have to see how, usually in this work that we are doing, how the epistemologies of the North has to be subjected to radical criticism, we have to know them, we have to engage with them, myself, yourself. We went through different trainings, but in the same countries probably. I was more in Germany, you were more in Belgium or whatever. But in fact, to bring in some new understanding of the world, because the understanding of the world by far exceeds the Western understanding of the world, there are also other ways of transforming of the world that are not in the script mm-hmm. of the Western modernity and the ideas of progress and whatever. Now, if we, taking all this experience we have been talking about, what do you think should the Europeans that are very far from our concerns, most of them, you know the dominant canon, mm-hmm. Even if they are so important here and still dominant, imagine there. I mean, it's very difficult to do the work, the type of work that I do. I feel very minority. I think the beginning that you are a minority. We imagine my case. Mm-hmm. In fact, it is very minority. What can we say to what they are missing? I mean, what the people that are not engaged with this rich conversation among different epistemologies, with other experiences of the world, other understandings, other cosmovisions, other philosophies, why this reductionism that is still so important and becomes, it seems to be becoming more important now with neoliberalism, with one size fits all mm-hmm. in the capitalist terms, in cultural terms, and so on and so forth. They are missing something, and I don't know whether they still can listen to an appeal to open their minds to this exciting, marvelous reality that we live all the time, paying mm-hmm. attention to the diversity of the world. How could we address them to be more open to the experience of the world?
I like the word you used, listen. Mm-hmm. Listen. You see, the trajectory that you have described shows quite clearly that there is deliberate intention not to listen. Mm-hmm. You and I are aware that the humanities, and more particularly philosophy, is sidelined all the time. Why do you have to study this? What job are you going to get with studying philosophy? So, you know, don't study useless things. study things that will give you a job. I suspect you have seen one of my articles under the title, From the Isolation to the Consolation of Philosophy. Just to argue this point that, you know, when you isolate and pretend that you can kill philosophy, what you are actually doing is really to say, okay, there is only one God for all human beings, and that God is the God of money. Anything else that does not lead you to accumulation of money, put aside. You are not, by so doing, engaging in learned ignorance, the doctor ignorance. No, you're not. You are actually being stubborn in refusing to open your ears so that you may, and eyes, of course, mm-hmm. so that you may see, so that you may hear other things. Mm-hmm. That type of attitude really can make one suppress philosophy. Why? Because it is by definition unphilosophical. A philosopher proper mm-hmm. is one who in the first place knows not how to hear. Everybody can hear. But the philosopher knows how to listen. Mm-hmm. And okay. this is the point. So those who refuse to listen are not going to be made to hear by us making an appeal. Mm-hmm. No. We will speak as the minority and act as the minority. And this speech and action as the minority will surely have an impact on them. Because even if they don't want to listen, the forces of nature are always interacting. And then they will feel a prick. And somehow, the prick will now invite them to, at least I heard, now I think I must begin to listen. Because if I'm not listening, even what I think I have been protecting, I'm going to lose. So our action and speech should bring them to a point where they are threatened that they are going to lose something. Yes, it must be real. It must be, yes, a real and living threat. So real and imminent danger, as the American jurists will say. If it is real and imminent, then they have no choice but to take care of it and to respond. And so I would say minority is not a problem. The problem is the minority's will to continue and resolution and determination to go ahead. You should remember also, I mean, can we imagine that a certain gentleman had a team of 12. Mm-hmm. Out of that team of 12, one betrayed him, and so he was left with 11. So out of 11, Do you see the confusion the world is in today? Just out of a team of 11. So, you see, minority is not an issue for me.
No.
It's really the will and the resolution
to go on. Absolutely.
Exactly.
Thank you very much, Professor Omar. It was wonderful. Thank you. It was
much.
A wonderful Thank conversation. You. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
We deserve it.